Hello everyone, my name is Adrian.
I'm Nick.
And welcome to another episode of Connect. Today we're bringing in Thomas Omholt, a low power RF applications manager. I wanted to bring him in to talk about what he works on a day-to-day basis, and also some of the challenges and applications you face with the different technologies you have in your portfolio. So maybe to kick things off, what are some of the technologies that you support in your team?
So mainly our technologies are the sub 1 gigahertz, the Zigbee, the Bluetooth, and essentially everything else but Wi-Fi. That's basically what we do. Okay. So all the really low power applications, these are mainly grid infrastructure and also home automation and building automation.
Okay. Yeah, and I guess today we're gonna dive into one of the specific low power enablers on those devices. Really quick, can you cover, just so we have a baseline, the part numbers, which devices we're talking about and kind of what they are?
Yeah, so we have, over the last 3 or 4 years, we've had a family of devices. They're the 1310 and the 2640 R2. They're 128 kilobytes of flash. And then we have the new ones that we just launched earlier this year. These are the 1312s, the 1352s, the 2642s and 52s.
Okay.
So these devices cover both sub 1 gigahertz, 2.4 gigahertz, and now also dual band and multi-mode applications.
Okay, very good. Yeah, and thinking through the devices and protocols, they're all very low power when you talk about Zigbee or Thread or sub 1 gigahertz, or Bluetooth low energy, it's normally associated with low power, oftentimes battery operated. So let's talk about specifically how we achieve some of the low power operation on these devices.
Yeah, so an application is two things. You have to have a wireless protocol that can send the data to the customer's back end somehow, but you also need to be able to sense this data. You need to be able to actually collect the data. So you gotta look at what applications are we trying to solve. It can either be grid, and consider this could be a gas meter or a water meter or an electricity meter. And there's some kind of sensor that needs to aggregate the amount of gas or water being consumed. These are typically counting based, or they also could be time of flight based. There's various ways of getting this data, but the umbrella around all this stuff is it has to be very, very low power. So how do we achieve low power? And to do this, what we've done on these series of devices is that we've added a new little controller that we call the sensor controller. This is a fully autonomous device that runs outside of the RTOS environment. This is one of the main things for being able to save power, is that we are not waking up the main cortex and we're not having to talk to the main operating system of the device. This little sensor controller sits there and can react very fast and be outside the RTOS. This is one of the main enablers for getting low power.
Okay, and this the sensor controller is fully configurable by the developer.
Yes, so that's something that's very differentiated in our devices, that our sensor controller, it is very small, but it is still programmable. The way that it is programmed is through a suite that we call Sensor Controller Studio. It's a free download off TI.com. And customers can download this studio and they can write their own application for the sensor controller. But these applications are quite small. So the debug that we have on this sensor controller is quite limited. But it's okay because the applications are very small. So typically, the sensor controller only has, on the earlier device, it only had 2 kilobytes of total memory space. On the new device, it has 4 kilobytes of total memory space. And the total memory space, this is both program and data. So it is very small.
Cool. And 4 kilobyte might sound small, but you can actually do quite a lot with that. And I know you mentioned grid. I guess building automation can also be enabled using the sensor controller as well.
Absolutely. So we've done a lot of applications with gas and water meter where they're looking at counting pulses, because that is how they actually measure the data. And these pulse counting features is something you can do with a Cortex M4 that wakes up a GPIO, but there's a lot of overhead involved in this and the power consumption numbers are not that good. If you do the same thing on the sensor controller, there's almost no overhead in counting the pulses, storing the data locally in the Cortex or in the sensor controller's SRAM, and then getting it later.
Very cool.
And then you can also change the application. For instance, if you're not doing counting maybe you're doing something more advanced in a home automation or building automation, where you actually want to negotiate with an external accelerometer. This external accelerometer is custom for you, or it could be something else. You actually need to have a language on there. The sensor controller is advanced enough and flexible enough that you can program these things in.
Very cool.
Okay, so yeah, so if I understand, these devices you talked about, the 26XX and the 13XX, it's a whole wireless MCU, and then this sensor controller is kind of an integrated core on that MCU that allows you to sense while kind of the rest of the system sleeps.
That's correct, yes.
Okay.
And it's integrated. So I have some customers asking about, hey, is this like a separate die that you put in the package, or what have you done here? And no, this is actually a monolithic integration. It runs off its own power domains on the chip, but it is just a single die.
Okay. Yeah. And not only is the advantage that you can sense at a very low power, but because of some of the peripherals and the memory that you're about to get into, you can actually program it and make a decision based on the input.
Yes, and you can even do rudimentary math functions on there. You can add some values together, do a little bit of basic filtering on there, and then if a certain event has happened, especially for an accelerometer, you're looking at maybe no data, but you want to disregard certain types of accelerometer events, mm-hmm. but you're looking for specific events, the sensor controller is advanced enough to do basic filtering like this of events.
Okay.
Very cool. And I know you've got a block diagram here. I don't know if you want to maybe walk through some of the capabilities of the sensor controller.
Sure, we can do that, yeah.
Awesome.
So we have the main a block diagram of a CC device down here. You have a Cortex M4F. It has its own flash, its own RAM. It has an RF device. And then we have this sensor controller element that we want to describe in a little bit more detail here. So what we did up here was kind of blew out what are all the features that we have in here. So the sensor controller is a 32-bit RISC core. A lot of people ask, is this an ARM core or not? It is not. This is a proprietary core that TI has developed. It has been optimized for low power. It has very, very low gate count. Then on board, we also have a TDC. This is a time-to-digital converter. This is used for time of flight or also used for cap touch. So this can be used for both of these things. Then we have a number of low power timers, and we have a very low power counter on board. This is specifically for doing gas and water meter counting, as I described earlier. Mm-hmm. And then we have a multiplying element on board that we can do some basic math on board. In the analog domain, we have, of course, access to the 12-bit ADD controller that's on chip. We also have two comparators. One is fast, and the other one is low power. Low power is actually 0.3 microamps. Wow. So therefore, the entire system, if you're using this comparator here, would be running at 1.2 microamps of active current. And then we also have a DAC on board and a current source. So with these devices, and this current source here is programmable. So with these features on board, people are able to make a lot of different things and a lot of different measurements. So for instance, with a current source, you can have an external resistor, and you could do a basic thermometer, a basic temperature sensing element. With this DAC, you can program some kind of a feedback loop to it. So there's a lot of things that can happen with this. It's up to the customers and their own creativity about what kind of solution they can solve with this thing. On the sensor control studio, we have a number of out-of-box experiences, we have 7 or 8 different things that can be done. And one of the things that we've actually done in here, we've implemented a software-based UART. Basically, this shows you, hey, we can use the sensor controller for something that it wasn't originally intended to do by just adding some software to it.
Very cool.
Okay.
Yeah.
And which, is there a subset of these peripherals that are shared, or with the Cortex M4, are these all sensor controller peripherals?
I think it's a very good question. These are not shared, but the 12-bit ADD controller is shared.
Okay.
So this ADC is either running off the sensor control domain or is running off of the main Cortex M4 domain.
Okay.
So it can be used both places.
But even so, the sensor controller can run, use the ADC while the Cortex M4 and the RF core are sleeping.
Yes, that's correct. Yes.
And that's what allows that 1.2 microamp type operation.
Yep. Yeah. So we have customers looking at this as this device because it enables a whole new paradigm of low power, where they have been looking at doing 5 or 10 microamps of average current consumption for their sensing application. Now with this device, they can get down into like 1 or 2 microamps.
Wow.
And this enables them to run, instead of 6 months on a small battery, now they can run for 2 years on a small battery. And that opens up whole new markets.
Wow. All right, very cool. Thanks, Thomas, for explaining, teaching us a little more about the sensor controller. The wheels are already spinning in my head on what kind of cool applications this can enable. I'm sure everybody watching is going to want to get started. Can they get started today with this?
Absolutely. So we have all the launch pads available for both families of devices. These launch pads are available worldwide for purchase on TI.com. The sensor controller studio that I briefly described is available for a download, and there will be a link provided below. And then also the Code Composer Studio, which is also required to work with this, is also available for download. So everything is available today.
Great.
Perfect.
Well, thanks again, Thomas. Thank you guys for tuning in to this episode of Connect. Go get started and play with the sensor controller. It's very cool. If you have any feedback on topics you'd like discussed or feedback on the show, you can tweet at us at sensor2cloud. And be sure to tune in next week. We're going to have a very cool demo running for you guys. Thanks.